Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I am SocioPsycho, and today we're going to be taking a look at OTTTD, a game created by SMG Studios, available for PC, Mac, and Linux. Now, that stands for Over-the-Top Tower Defense Game, and no doubt, my astute audience, you've picked up that the game is indeed a tower defense genre. What does it do right? What does it do wrong? Is it worth your money? Or do you already enthralled by the game but have a question on a single topic? Well, this review is aimed to cover all those issues, and if you're looking for one thing, then check the video bar on the side. Now we'll simply start by going into the options menu. There are no rebindable keys, and while this isn't a big deal because you can move around with the keyboard to view the map with your arrow and WASD, and your hero abilities can be accessed through 1 through 9 and you can select your heroes by F1 to 3, I haven't found an issue in needing to rebind the keys, but it's still something to be noted. Now it does have a large variable of screen resolutions and quality and graphic settings. This is always nice to see developers put that little effort in, and while the quality of the game may be pretty low and basic in the detail that they put in, the art style of the game is actually very well done, and very interesting choice indeed. The sound effects and the music, nice to have these options. The music is very well done. It helps propel the battle and the epicness of the battles without being too overimposing or draining on your ears. It helps keep the atmosphere really relevant to the battles that you're fighting. The gore amount isn't anything all that disgusting or bad. If you want to turn it off for any reason, the main point I could see is because it just ends up being cluttering and your computer may not be able to handle that level of clutter, or you just find it distasteful. It's not really all that glory, it's just simply humorous and adds a little bit of character to when you actually defeat an enemy, they explode into different little body parts comically due to the art style of the game. So let us go into the game here, and you can see you have a choice to select from three different slots. Now this may be good for some, and some may be upset that they don't have the availability for more slots depending on how many people are playing on their computer. For me, this was an issue, and this was more than fine as I am the only person who is going to be accessing this. When we go in here, you can see that there is a very easy and straightforward layout of the missions you are able to select. It's very nice that it's straight up in your face. In the bottom, you have the team management, and you go in, and there are 7 characters in all that you're able to unlock. Now, in the future, they might add more characters, but right now, there's just the 7. Each of these characters have different characteristics: engineer, assault, recon, rocketeer, saboteur, and bombardier, scientist, and these play out important roles in how they act, as well as the abilities that they can take into combat with them. Such as a recon is more of a sniper, so you want to keep them further away from enemy damage because it's not going to be able to take much pain. And the saboteur has great low range damage to light creatures, but his abilities rely more in doing mass amounts of damage through his landmines versus just being a straight up tank, unlike some of the others. And when we go into the skill points, as you can see, everything is resettable. There's no issue on that front. I haven't found the game to stifle me in any reason. On the top left, as you can see, you have your money, which you gain after each mission, and medals. Medals are gained after winning a victory, and you can use these to either resurrect one of your fallen troops in the purchase of armor or weapons alongside of gold, not one or the other, and resetting your skill points. The different characteristics of these heroes play out a huge role in how the game actually propels forward. Each mission and map may be separate in what it offers you challengingly, but who you decide to take in will make all the difference. If you take in the engineer who has the capability to add remote repair to a tower, then he won't have to be near that tower in order to actually repair it. All these characters have different traits and characteristics, which allow them or give them an upgrade in battle where the other ones do not. This could be anything from having AoE damage or simply faster repair, a longer line of sight for the sniper, call in air support, whatever it is, there's different characteristics and a lot of depth in what you're able to pick from with these characters. you have really a choice in between passive skills and active ability skills. Now, you can take two active ability skills into combat with you, but you have up a selection to five that your character can unlock. This is really nice as it gives you the availability to play the character as you wish to. And that's really nice because not only do you get to say, okay, I like this character because I'm relatable to him, so I'm going to play as this guy, but also the abilities that they decide to take in depend upon where you put your points and what you want to focus on. Do you want to try to be shielding and have stronger defense, or do you want to go more damage and mitigation? The abilities sync very well into the armor and the weapons, as all of this ties together to allow you to build these characters the way you want more than anything else. As you gain levels, you gain skill points. Each level you get 3 points, and each of these abilities cost a certain amount to purchase. As you can see, next to each one of these abilities there is a number. When it comes to the weapons, each weapon does more damage as you progress forward. The engineer would seem to have a lot more weapons than the others, but at the same time, he's one of the ones that you start with, so it makes sense that you'll be usually having him with most of your playthroughs, until you at least unlock others and find another to fill his slot that you enjoy more. The better the weapon, the more damage, and it really does make a difference when you focus him perhaps more on DPS in his abilities and then give him a really good weapon, and you have his armor match. All these different characteristics and traits make a big role, but it doesn't break the balance of the game, and that's really important. When we go into armor, as you can see, there's different types of armors, and they do different things. One may increase your mitigation against damage, but at what price? You may sacrifice your damage and attack range, or you'll increase your damage and attack range, but sacrifice additional health or damage protection. So it really allows you to pick where and what type of character you want to build. Do you want to try to stall enemies by having them attack your character? Or do you want to try to hide behind your towers and burn down the enemy as fast as possible? Each character also has a unique armor set that is individual to them. For the engineer, it was repairing things faster. As something for the recon, as you can see, it increases movement speed, his skill loadout, and his skill duration. Your active abilities will be majorly increased, where the engineer was more passive abilities increased. These play a huge role, but not an overincumbence. As the campaign is 25 levels long, and the game is not one for people who have never played a tower defense game, it starts off fair, and I've never felt the balance of the game to be too unjust. It requires you to be knowledgeable. And I respect the game for saying, hey, we're not going to fucking hold your hand. If you want to win, then you need to work for it. And it does have a bit of a climb in the difficulty, and it's about you understanding not only what towers you have available, but what your hero units do, your weapons and your abilities and the passives, where you want to build your character, what character do you want to take in, as they each have different characteristics, from tank to AoE damage to sniper damage to support to control to repair. And these missions all relate around that. They are very important that you don't have to select one exact way of doing it. Now, there may be a more beneficial way of doing it with one selection of characters, but it doesn't mean it's impossible with others. And obviously, if that selection of characters isn't leveled up with the proper weaponry, then you're going to be finding an easier time doing it with your desired group. This difficulty continues in the endless mode. The endless mode level I played, I made it to round 5. It's really not all that impressive. It really kicked my ass, and I want to get further into it. But it is very, very abusive in its difficulty, not its fairness, and that is very important to state. The levels may climb in a difficulty very radically, but not to an unfair state. Anybody who's interested in this has experience in tower defense games or is a veteran, then you will enjoy this game. But it will probably turn off a lot of new people because there is a lot of in-depth things that you need to know in order to survive some of the missions, especially as it gets harder and harder up. I got stuck at level 17, Unfortunately, as I do wish to continue playing and beat that past level 17, right now it's where I've hit my wall and I need to reassess the units I have that I took into the battle, the tower layout, and the map and the enemy types. It really makes you have to think, and I respect it for that because it says, if you want to beat our levels, then guess what? You need to actually fucking work for it. We're not going to hold your hand. Now, another nice thing is when you go into the actual mission, you can have your quick look at who's in your squad, who you're taking into battle, because out of 7 characters, you can take 3 into battle. A little mission detail, and the level of stars that you've completed on the mission or whatnot. This is nice because you can always edit the characters that you want to take into battle, or you can swap them out, so you can change your gear load or swap them out. Now, this tower defense game is not unique in its decision how its tower defense base is run, but it's not something you see too often either. In the usual tower defense game, the whole point is to keep enemies from escaping from a map. They start in point A and they're going to point B, and you have to stop them. If you don't, you don't get the kills, because after each kill, you gain money. In this one, it's a little bit different as a fact of you need to stop them from getting from your headquarters. If they get to your headquarters, they will damage it. As you can see at the bottom right corner is the health bar of the command center. If a command center is defeated, you will lose the mission. So it doesn't matter if you've made it to the last round and there's only one guy who makes it to your command center, because if he manages to destroy it, you will lose. This is a nice take, but it is a more difficult take. It's not just a more difficult take in the fact that it says, hey, you need to kill every single monster, but you need to understand what tools you have available for yourself. Now, they do a very good job at marking the placements of where you can put towers. It's very clear, it's very legible, and it really is no misunderstanding. The only complaint that you might be able to make justifiable about the location of the towers is the fact that if you have gore on a high setting, after you kill more and more and more, it may be harder to see where you can place a tower. But by then, you usually have the towers placed out or a tower or nation upon where you want. Different towers do different things. And while you have 4 base towers to choose from, the difficult part in any tower defense game is how do I make my towers not become irrelevant? How do I make it so a player doesn't just use one tower all the time? And this is really important, and they do a really good job with that. They divide the towers into 4 different categories. You have an energy plasma cannon, you have a gauntlet gun, machine gun, whatever, heavy ordnance machine gun, you have a slow pulse riding electrical field which slows down the enemy, allowing you to do more damage to them while they're in that range of that weapon. And they also have a rocket that fires missiles. On each of these different towers, you also have the choice to upgrade them in between 2 unique styles for that type of tower. So a machine gun can then make himself an elite version, something completely different than the energy gun can make of himself in an elite version. So there's a lot more towers than just 4, and each tower can be upgraded to a tier 3. This offers a lot of depth, and you think, okay, well, how do you have that much and still keep it balanced? And the trick is, and they do this very well, is by having each tower do a separate type of damage or being a support unit. And the way the enemies are, the different types of enemies and the different types of mitigation against damage they have. So if you have a crab tank, which is really strong against piercing damage, is able to be damaged fairly well by laser cannons or rockets, then this is where the variation comes up. How they progress with the different types and styles of monsters is what really matters the most. They do an excellent job of having a wide variety to where you feel that you need to have an understanding of what your different towers do. Because if you go into a map that's very heavy on high-end creatures, then you need to have the right synergy. Now, there are different weapons that allow for a more powerful attack, but when you upgrade some towers to an elite version, they usually become more weaker. Ways around that because you don't want your hero to have to stand next to a vulnerable position perhaps, because he may be under attack or die, is there are support towers such as this one, which offers a ray of shielding around the hero or the towers. This is really good because it allows a variety of saying, okay, my heroes can be stationed in one place and I can still use all my towers in another. The tower layout, I've never felt as if I didn't need to use one of the towers. Now, different battles and different maps do require different ways of dealing with different enemies. This is just how the game works because it offers variety, but it does not get old. There's a point and a reason to use different types of towers instead of just feeling like you're using the same ones over and over again. This is also where it comes into the difficulty. Because you have to know what these towers do and the depth and how to synergize them very well together comes down to the fact that you need to understand tower defense games pretty well. Because if you don't, then you're just going to end up being overrun because you didn't know how to synergize certain towers with your troops and able to stop the enemy. The difficulty may be harsh as the levels continue to rise, but it's not unfair. It's difficult, but it's just. When we're talking about fighting different enemies, it also comes into the hero abilities. As I said earlier, you can take two hero abilities into combat with you. This is very important in helping you defeat the enemy or stopping their attack upon you. Different heroes have different abilities. If you use a rocket to destroy a bunch of infantry, it'll help eliminate some of the peon who you use it on and clean out and give you some breathing room. But it also comes down to whether you want to use mines, and you want to use mines in a very active way or use mines in more of a defensive way. You have it set up so, if anybody gets past my points, then I'm going to use mines in order to try to stop them. There's also sniper abilities, which can call in support for other towers, the ability to mark a target, and any missile towers you have will attack that target for a duration the mark is on it, no matter how far away it is. And they can also call in air support. Now, the thing about air support that I like and I don't like is the fact that, yes, this is a really good and nice ability, but the art style and the graphic fidelity of a chopper that comes in, the engines don't move, it has rockets on its top, but it never fires it, it just has a cannon. It feels very lacking in its power. While most of the game does have this sense of powerful explosion, death, and complete warlike feeling, where there's battle going on and you set down a mine and the mine explodes and you get body parts of 12 different monsters going everywhere, and there's chunks flying everywhere, and it's this sense of like, wow, this is really epic. The chopper really lets that down, and it's really unfortunate if that's one of your main abilities you like using. Now, I haven't looked through every single ability, and so I can't give you an in-depth analysis, nor would I waste your time on such. But for the most part of the game, it feels powerful, and it respects your time, and that's the important thing. I never felt as if my time was disrespected while playing. I actually look forward to playing this game more, not something I can say about all games I review. The game is fair, and the enemy variety is humorous. You have creatures such as fish cannons, to swollen puffin fish that fly, and when they blow up, they drop fish cannons. They've got fish in giant tanks, which add a shield, an energy shield, to other allies. There's a lot of variety in the game. You have tanks of different sorts, crabs, zombies, pillow ghosts, sheet ghosts, skulls, turtle tanks, people who shop at Walmart. You got all this different variation of creatures, and it's really humorous at times to see these and fight against these. Unfortunately, while that ties in very well with the difficulty because you have to make sure you understand what your towers are doing and how to handle the situation, it goes into the level design of the game. I feel that while the level design is done in the pathing system alone very well, the artistic style is reused on many of the maps. Now, yes, if you go to a forest-like area that's haunted, of a pathing system that you'll be attacked and the enemy will move to your headquarters may be different and more challenging as the missions progress, but the atmosphere of fighting for a fourth time in this forest gets a little stale. Now, I'm not saying that you need to be fighting on a space station or on the moon or anything else that's crazy, but it would have been nice to have a variation in color and different graphic layouts rather than just sort of the same reusing of the maps. Because while the pathing may be great, the atmosphere loses a little bit of its charm the more you continue to see the same levels. Now, one thing to note is that the game, like I've been saying, is fair. And even so, when you die, it is a rogue-lite essence version of death. Because when one of your characters dies in a battle, he will be taken out of that battle. His body will explode. And you have this, depending on what battle you're fighting and how far you are in it, it might just end up having to restart because without your hero, you may be at severe disadvantage. But the nice thing for both angles is the fact, as I said, after each mission, you get money and a medal. When you die, you can reclone your hero or you can wait for the cloning process to finish. The cloning process takes 45 minutes. So if you continue to play with another character and you go back about 3 missions later, it won't be a problem. It's like, okay, only 45 minutes, so I'll go away and come back, or I'll play other with another character. Whatever the case is, it's not that long, and it's like, it slaps you on the hand for saying, oh, shame on you for dying, you should know better. But it doesn't take away your toys. And you can just simply reclone it at loss of a medal if you truly wish to. And I respect that. I like it gives you that option of either deal with your consequences or pay a small fine for dealing with your consequences. The issue I have with the game, the borderline problem that I found with the game, simply comes from, one, while yes, you can easily click F1 to F3 to select the different characters to move them, you cannot click and drag your mouse in order to actually move it past and over and gather up your troops and move them into a position. This is really unfortunate, as in the later levels, as the battles continue to get more hectic, you may need to move all your troops in a dime's notice, and you don't have time to fidget around with 1, 2, 3. Being able to just quickly drag and move would have been far better than not being able to, and it's really, really unfortunate that they do not have that option. My second issue with the game is the fact that there is no way to actually give orders to your towers or your men upon who you want them to kill. You cannot order them to attack the one who's weakest for most, the one who has the most armor or weakest armor or the most health or the less health, the one that's further on the path or the one that's closer on the path. Because you cannot choose which target you want them to go after, there is a severe issue in either having to micromanage your troops to tag along trying to hunt down a monster that escaped past your line, and you're trying to kill him and run forward and kill him and run forward and kill him, or when there's two monsters, and one is at, say, 10% health and he's the weaker, and another is at 90% health and he's the stronger, it would be so much nicer to be able to target the weaker one first, but it doesn't. It targets the stronger one. This really adds a level of annoyance rather than difficulty. It goes into the age issue, which many people suffer from, which you mainly see in MMOs, which is allowing the NPC to tank you. You see this a lot in MMOs where people have to clean out a room in a dungeon, and instead of focusing on the 5 adds, they go after the strongest creature in the room, and they end up dying because all the adds killed them. This game suffers from the same issue, except you don't die as much or suffer as greatly as an issue for it, but it's still very annoying not to be able to allow you to decide and control over who you attack first. The other issue falls into the combat control as well. The three main issues of the game, which do not necessarily destroy the game, but do add extra time and annoyance in some areas. The third one being the fact that you do not have any way to actually increase the speed of your gameplay. Most tower defense games have a times 2, 4, 8, or 16, and even some a crazy 32% faster. This allows you to speed up the game and it will progress as monsters will move through the map faster, towers will attack faster, everything will happen at a faster pace. The game doesn't even have a times 2 button, and I found myself waiting around quite a lot at many points where I could have easily just sped it up and kept the tempo and the base much more enjoyable to my speed. Because it comes down to simply this. If I know the enemy is coming at me, and my towers I know are solid, then I should have the capability to speed up the game so I don't have to wait for the slowness of the game to go through it. My issues with the game are things that could easily be patched, and I severely hope that these issues do get patched in the game in the future, as it would only help benefit the game, not hurt it. But these issues of not being able to have the control over the battlefield as you wish are still very serious issues. Now, the thing that doesn't bother me is the fact that they don't have a tactical pause. If you pause, it will bring up an option of resume or quit. This is another little issue here because you don't have a restart option. And if you're a purist in a way of not allowing any monsters through or allowing any damage to happen to your tower, this is a severe annoyance because you have to go back into the mission select screen instead of just being able to hit escape, restart, and start the mission over again. You get that one tick of damage on your tower and you have to go all the way back out instead of just reloading the map. This is an oversight on their part and one I hope that gets fixed. Again, these are small things, but there's still things which add a little bit of annoyances. The tactical option of the pause menu doesn't bother me. And it doesn't bother me because it adds a level of difficulty for when you start the mission, you may be a little disorientated and not knowing what you're going to face. And I can understand that, I get that, it's a war, it's a battlefield, I'll give you that. On top of it, it gives you a fair amount of time, about 30 seconds, to get yourself situated and get your towers organized in the way you may want. Do everything as a RTS, I can respect as a difficulty increaser, not as the game being unfair or unjust to me. It requires you to be vigilant more than anything else, and so I'm perfectly fine with the choice that they have selected for that. Overall, at the end of the day, throughout the hours of playing of this game, to make it as far as I did, only to be stonewalled by the difficulty of this game, I can gladly recommend it. It is a hard game at times. It is one for definitely experienced and veteran tower defense gamers, but it's one of comedic and enjoyment, one where the towers and depth of the characters all synergize very well, and the enemies and the maps have a great and changing route system upon where you never feel like the difficulty or your time is ever wasted. It is balanced fairly, and I have enjoyed the time I have spent in the game, and I look forward to beating some of the levels I haven't yet. As always, I thank you for your viewership, and I'll see you next time.